I'd love to know how your cultural background informs your songwriting and your music, as well as the activism. How does all of this amazing work that you're doing outside and your cultural heritage is obviously a really major part of your music. And I must say too that I've absolutely loved listening to the tracks that you've sent us. We feel very blessed that we get a sneak peek at some of these tracks, which we're very, very lucky, very blessed. But if you could answer to how does activism and your cultural background inform your music?
Okay. It's influenced, it impacts me as a woman. I will go back to when I was a child, 3-4 years old. I grew up with my brother, just my sibling and I. You know, we like 1 year difference, okay? Just the two of us then. And my mother, she was the busy type, but then she would always create the time, the leisure time together. Whether it's between 30 minutes to 1 hour every day, she would dedicate time, okay? And what she does is she would tell us stories, African tales, right? And these tales are usually accompanied by singing, dancing, you know? And
sorry, hang on a second. No. That's my dog.
And these folk tales were really intriguing stories, you know, about animals and how they would behave, about their behaviors, about their songs, about how they would dance, each animals and all of that. So, and whenever my mom wasn't around and my brother and I, we had finished our, doing some homework, I would propose to tell a story to my brother. And he's like, but you're not going to remember anything. I would just invent a story. And the first story I invented was about a man who was going to the farm. And on his way to the farm, he met a woman and fell in love with the woman. And they became a man and wife. And that's when I actually wrote my first song. And I created a song for it as well, which goes, Odugbo anam yo horie o, Odugbo, Odugbo anam yo horie o, Odugbo. Meaning, you can get a wife, you find a wife on your way to the farm.
That's wonderful, and you still remember it. That's amazing, Sonia.
Yes. So, yes, you know, when you grow up in that environment where your mom, she was an actress, a singer, and then back in the days, I would go to some of the rehearsals with her, and they would do traditional folks, you know, beautiful, lovely, with percussion, a cappella singing, you know, shaking rattles, you know, swinging in the air. It was such an amazing experience, you know. And I also learned that my dad loved the arts. He wasn't an artist. I didn't get to know my dad because he passed away when we were babies.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, thank you. He loved the arts as well. So I think from there as well, what happened, I became baptized in the Holy Spirit. I was a part of the Catholic Charismatic Renewal. I was a very devoted Christian. So I believe I was the youngest chorister in the choir. I was 10, 11 years, and I was chosen to sing solo as well. So I was groomed by my master, you know, we will have the choir master. So I was groomed by him along the way. And then in my secondary school, we had competition. Of course, you know, in school, either you have, sometimes you have home economics, you have sports, and then you have culture. Mm-hmm. Guess where I would go? I would do culture and sports as well. But home economics, I never loved that. So, and then I would do competition, singing competition with my school, representing my school. So it just kept on going. And when I traveled to Italy, of course, I didn't, there was no place for African music. Of course, I had to study jazz music and interpretation because the school I went, they auditioned me and felt that I had that voice that, you know, suits jazz. So that was why I chose that. And then I was learning about Ella Fitzgerald, Billie Holiday.
Oh, Mahalia wonderful, Jackson, wonderful, you know, music, yes.
Yeah. I started creating, my style was just coming as well. I started writing my own lyrics, my music, and then you will see that it's influenced by what I learned from my mother, from the environment I grew up, because I believe I have been able to be strong in my identity. Because when you are able to acknowledge your identity, your root, and you value it, then that root never lets you go. Wherever you go, that root is with you. Whatever you do, that positive part of your root always stays by you. And that came from those folk tales that had wise adages that shaped attitudes. They were not just adages of "you're beautiful" and like this. No, they were adages about behavior, about kindness, about how to show the compassion towards one another, towards your siblings, towards your neighbor, towards your community, about how to be truthful to yourself. When you are truthful to yourself, you will always be truthful to people, about not to allow materialistic things overwhelm you. Because when you begin to be materialistic, the more you want to, you are thinking about flashy cars, big homes, and all of that, without keeping people in mind, the more you are also channeled to think about yourself. But the more you take life, you see life from another perspective, that life indeed is a marketplace where we come to trade and then go back home, then you always have in the back of your mind that whatever you have, you own, does not belong to you. So even if it's little you have and you see somebody close to you in need, you don't expect that person to ask you before you assist. You just do it. So that's where I grew up, not to tell lies. Even I can't tell lies. I can't say no to people. Like, it's difficult for me to say no. You know, because of that environment I grew up in, because of those tales, they are still in my head. They ring in my head. The songs, the words, the movement, even sometimes like, I want to act differently. I'm like, oh, why am I so this? Why am I so good? Why am I? Let me just try to be nasty. It can never happen. No, I can be nasty. And you hear that inner voice within you saying, hey, Sonia, what are you doing? Are you out of your senses? Come on, girl. You know, it makes you